It has been hot, hot, hot here in the Phoenix area. And along with Rick Horton and Pat Parris, I'm Dan McLaughlin. We're at Chase Field. Boy, it's been hot, but it's nice inside.
And the Cardinals team has been hot, 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 too. Swinging the bat last 3 days. Terrific offense. We'll see what they can do against Ruby De La Rosa, who has been very good, winning 5 of his last 7 starts.
Carpenter, Pham, Hayward, unique lineup tonight. Peralta, Wong, and Moss, Cruz, Garcia, Martinez. On the bench, all right-handed with Molina, Borges, Reynolds, Cosma, and Piscotty. Cardinals looking for win number 82 here tonight. And the first pitch is taken for a ball. Ruby De La Rosa, start number 26 as he's 11-5. Here's a 1-0 pitch.
De La Rosa is a hard thrower, and he likes to get ground balls, a lot like Carlos Martinez. 6'1", 225, 26-year-old right-hander. He had that one start a year ago against the Cardinals, and he was very good in that outing.
And the count runs to 3-0. It is odd when you see a first baseman as the leadoff man in your lineup. It's been done a combined 35 times this year by 3 different teams. That's taken for a ball. The Mariners, the Padres, and the Phillies. And now 36th time with Matt Carpenter. The Hyundai pitch arsenal.
Four-seamer, changeup, sinker, and a slider for De La Rosa. The four-seamer can get up to 95 miles an hour, but he prefers the ground ball. He's not going to get 8, 9, 10 strikeouts. Doesn't normally walk a lot of batters, but not a good start for him against Carpenter.
And here's Tommy Pham. Short lead at first by Carpenter. Pham looks at a pitch up and in, and just like that, Wellington Castillo out to visit.
Well, there have been talk here in Arizona about this special relationship between Castillo and De La Rosa. They grew up together in the same town in Dominican. They played Little League Baseball together. And the talk here is that Castillo has been kind of like the horse whisperer as far as De La Rosa is concerned. He'll go out, calm him down, and get results right away in almost a spectacular fashion. So these two really have a good relationship, and it goes way, way back.
Here's a 1-0. And just like that, it's a strike. Chip Hale said yesterday, that Pham kid, he's been fantastic. And why not? He's had a good series. Diving catch, 5 hits. He's shown off his speed. The 1-1. And Rick, everywhere we go, we're asked, how are the Cardinals doing this? No Holiday, no Adams, no Jay. The list goes on and on. No Adam Wainwright. Well, guys like Tommy Pham and Stephen Piscotty have stepped up in a big way.
It's a sign of the organizational depth that those players were first of all drafted and second of all developed properly by the minor league managers, hitting coaches, to get to this point, to know what they're doing. Credit to the, it's really organizational credit that the Cardinals are able to continue on. Mike Matheny is very tired of that question, and he again feels that his team is being insulted. Well, why wouldn't we continue to do well? I don't want to insult our backup players or our AAA players, but the point remains, these guys have done a phenomenal job.
Here's a 2-1. 3-1 with Hayward on deck. De La Rosa, one of the reasons why you have what would be almost a Sunday lineup. You've already won 3 games in the series, so you've won the series, but against left-handed batters, the average is 313 against him. Right-handers, 210. Three-one pitch to Tommy Pham. Inside, back-to-back walks to start game 4.
De La Rosa has had 2 high walk games. One came against Atlanta 2 starts ago where he walked 4. He had another start against Miami in July where he walked 5, but for the most part, he's 0-1 or 2. So very surprising.
And Rick, when you have walks like this, you think that the Arizona starters don't go deep, and they usually do not. Starting staff, the 6th Fewest innings among all rotations in baseball. He's getting an earful right now.
That's Mike Harkey, former Chicago Cubs pitcher, and that was not a how-do-you-do conversation.
No, sir. The defense, Peralta, Pollock, Inciarte in the outfield. Lamb, Owings, Hill, and Goldschmidt on the infield, and Castillo is behind the plate. That's presented by Dobbs Tire and Auto Centers. And in steps Jason Hayward with runners at first and second, and nobody out here at the top of the first.
So often we see a pitcher struggling with control. He just tries to throw one right down central, and the guy gives it a ride.
Will that happen here? First pitch, a strike. I don't care where you're seated here at the ballpark, you will know when it's a strike because Jim Joyce is as loud as any umpire, emphatic with his strike calls. He's the crew chief. Gibson at first, Fairchild at second, Hoberg is at third. The 0-1. Jim Joyce considered from the player's perspective as one of the best in the game. Very, very respected. That's not from the different ways to measure balls and strikes and whether a guy is out or safe. This is from the player's perspective. Hayward pops it up. Left side and out of play. One ball to two strikes.
I know for a lot of baseball fans it may seem backwards to have an aggressive approach against a pitcher who's just walked a couple of guys, but at this level it's a must. When a guy's struggling, you got to pounce on him. And if he's going to throw a fastball down central, you let it rip. Now, maybe if you're talking about Little League baseball and a pitcher can't throw a strike, you say, well, hey, let's make him throw a strike. But not at this level. You capitalize on it, drive the baseball.
Back-to-back walks, Carpenter and Pham. And the count is 1-2 on Jason Hayward. Outfield is deep and straight away. First strikeout for De La Rosa and the first out.
This is a sinker that doesn't really sink. It just kind of fades away. So he is not getting on top of that sinker. He gets away with it up in the zone because of the velocity against Hayward. But he's going to have to find a way to get that ball to have a little more downward tilt.
And that was a look at the Missouri Lottery Fox Tracks. Here's Johnny Peralta, 3-for-12 in the series. Overall batting 284, leads the club in hits, 16 homers, 58 RBIs. Rick, you mentioned last night, it's been a while since we've seen a home run from the Cardinals shortstop.
August 1st, he hit home run number 16, and around that time, he was leading the club in hits, RBIs, home runs, and Carpenter's passed him as far as the home runs and RBIs are concerned, but still leads St. Louis in hits. He's had a very good year offensively.
Play him just about straight up. Here's a 1-0. Pulled foul. One ball, one strike. Just past Jose Oquendo.
Been a very interesting year against the Diamondbacks. The Cardinals have won all six games, but five of those games have been close games. Only one blowout that happened a couple of nights ago, but the Cardinals in St. Louis won three games by a total of four runs.
They have never swept a four-game series here in Arizona. Also, they have never won every game against Arizona in an entire season, and it's so hard to do. Last time a National League team did that, sweeping seven or more games in a season series, was the 2011 Brewers against the Marlins, 7-0. It's just so hard to do that at this level. 3-1.
Well, you're bound to face their ace or a pitcher that happened to be on fire. And here we look at some clean slates. The Padres 9-0. Cardinals against the Padres in 2000. The Dodgers won all seven games. And Dan, you remember the 1899 season when they played so well against the Spiders.
Absolutely. The Perfectos were on fire that year.
Cy Young was having a good year. 40 complete games that season. Isn't that incredible?
It is. A 3-1 pitch instead of check on the runner at second base. You think about the home run against De La Rosa because he's allowed 25 this year, fifth most in the National League, but only one in the month of August in his four starts. And the 3-1 pitch to Peralta. 3-2. For fun, because I'm a baseball nerd, if you will. I love baseball. I love this game. I love the history of it. I do go back and look at some of those numbers from Babe Ruth or Cy Young. It's incredible. In particular, the pitching numbers.
Yeah, not everybody loves that, but it is interesting to see you guys that threw 50, 60 complete games, or I believe Cy Young had about 42 decisions that year.
Wow. 3-2. Back-to-back strikeouts for De La Rosa. And he's an out away from getting out of this jam. And it's up to Colton Wong to extend the inning.
We showed you the arsenal of De La Rosa. He has a changeup that he throws sporadically. But when he's on with it, he'll throw it repeatedly. But there'll be times where he'll just forget about it, maybe throw it once or twice in a start. But there are other starts where he'll throw it all night long. It just depends on how his feel is. He learned that changeup, by the way, from Pedro Martinez.
Two outs, two on. I had the chance to visit with Pedro Martinez one time, and we shook hands. And I came away just amazed at the length of his fingers. And he's talked about that, too, with the changeup, letting it go off the fingertips, which added to how great he was.
There were teams that gave up on him because he thought he was too small.
All the way to the Hall of Fame.
You'd hate to let De La Rosa off the hook here in the first inning.
The 1-1. Hit the other way, slicing fair off the bat of Wong. Carpenter will score. Colton Wong, his second double in this series, and this one results in a 1-0 St. Louis lead.
Well, there's a part of De La Rosa that's saying right now, boy, am I unlucky, because that's a little flare the other way. But it isn't really about luck, because the two walks that he gave up led to that run. One more look at the pitch, middle in. Colton fights it off the other way.
RBI number 51 for the Cardinals second baseman. And now it's Brandon Moss. Still looking for that first Cardinals home run. Runners at second and third. And the first pitch is taken for a ball. That uppercut swing, you see him just sky some of those fly balls that he hits. 1-1, one strike. And you've seen guys with those uppercut swings.
Oh, yeah.
Sometimes it's a blast, sometimes it's hit to the track, sometimes it's hit to the roof.
Well, a little more on the line in a ballpark like this. Moss certainly has the power to get it out of here. We've seen the ball carry in this series.
Boy, has it.
Quite a bit. 407 to straightaway center, but it's 413 in, I guess you'd call that right center and left center, but deep center field. And that's a long way out there, but these guys can hit it that far.
Second and third, and a 2-1 pitch to Moss. Two balls, two strikes.
He seems to be finding that changeup, and he's getting swings and misses with it. The fastball command wasn't there. 26 pitches already.
The 2-2 to Brandon Moss. On its way. Moss rips it to first, and what a play by Goldschmidt. Race to the bag. De La Rosa is there. Takes a hit and two runs away from the Cardinals. He was playing near the line. Every team plays in the pole. And Paul Goldschmidt comes up with a dazzling play at first base. Moss can't buy a break right now. That's the third and final out. 1-0 St. Louis. There's Ender Inciarte. He'll lead it off for Arizona. Then A.J. Pollock and Paul Goldschmidt. Peralta, Castillo and Lamb. Hill, Owings and De La Rosa. On the bench, switch hitting Jared Zoltolamacchia, Nick Ahmed, Hernandez and Yasmani Tomas. On the mound for the Cardinals, hard-throwing right-hander Carlos Martinez in start number 24.
Looking for victory number 13. Really should have 13 victories already, maybe more than that, but he really earned a victory the last time he saw the Diamondbacks. 7 innings, no runs. That came on the 25th of May. Had 8 strikeouts in that game in St. Louis.
Cardinals pitching, it's been great all year. It's continued here in this series. Last night, John Lackey was hit hard early on, and then, as we've talked about, he's made a habit, and a good one, of settling into the game. That's what he did. Jaime Garcia was very good. Garcia now with an ERA of 1.77 overall. And we were talking before the game, could Jaime be your comeback player of the year in the National League? There's some pretty big names out there as far as candidates. Matt Harvey would be one. Joey Votto would be one. But Garcia's got to be in that conversation, too.
I think there's no doubt he's been so solid. And he keeps piling up the starts. He has a good September. I think he's going to get a lot of votes for that.
Two balls, one strike. Inciarte hitting 295. That pitch taken low. When you watch Carlos Martinez, what do you watch for in particular?
I watch for tempo. If he's too fast or too slow, he's a little slow right now, actually, in his delivery. He always looks for that kind of right spot where he's got energy, but his body is in control. The Hyundai pitch arsenal for Martinez, the four-seamer, sinker, slider, and changeup, and like De La Rosa, he'll use whatever's working. If the slider's good, he'll go to it. If the changeup's good, he'll go to it. The best Carlos Martinez, to me, is the one that throws fastballs down in the zone and gets ground balls.
And he'd love to get one here. A.J. Pollock, he's hit into a couple of double plays in this series. That's been the theme of this series when you think about the Cardinals defensively. Double plays turned. Bases loaded, one out, twice against Lance Lynn in game one of this series. One of those times, Paul Goldschmidt hits into a double play. Here's a 1-0 pitch. Instead of check on Inciarte with 13 steals. And if they score in that point in time, maybe this is a different series. Because it sets the tone in the game. They're coming off a sweep of Cincinnati, and they're feeling good about themselves. Maybe it's a different series.
Well, that Goldschmidt at bat, and I think you're on something. I think if that is a different outcome, who knows what happens after that. Goldschmidt is such a good player. And credit Lance Lynn for making the pitch, number one. It was a 3-2 count. So you credit the pitcher, but the defense has to execute it, and they've been doing that flawlessly. Three double plays here last night.
You just wonder if Arizona will be more aggressive tonight in terms of stealing with Tony Cruz behind the plate. Overall, this is a very aggressive team in general terms. They're trying to pile up the stolen bases this year.
They run, they hit, and they score.
It's been a breakout year for A.J. Pollock. 321, 13 home runs, 54 RBIs to go along with 33 steals. Two and two. see Pham talking to Brandon Moss in left field. Now with two strikes, where they want to situate themselves. Pham moving a few steps to his left and right center. And a ground ball that's hit to short. Can they turn two? Yes, sir. 6-4-3. Peralta, Wong, Carpenter.
Pollock is frustrated with himself here for hitting into another double play. That's Enciarte, who's forced to go down. Pollock frustrated with himself, but there's a guy who hits into double plays because he's making contact, too. He's having such a good year offensively. He's a hard line drive ground ball type hitter, and that's part of the reason he hits into so many double plays.
Nine turned by the Cardinals in this series. I want to go back to a conversation you had with Jose Oquendo in the neighborhood play. You just saw the slide by Enciarte as Goldschmidt takes a ball and it's 2-0. With Oquendo, you talked about with a turn, there's a way to get guys to slide.
Well, you get him to slide, you get him to slide early when you kind of go down with your throw and make them slide. You drop down a little bit, you can kind of make sure they clear out.
Cardinals defensively tonight. Moss, Pham, Hayward in the outfield. Garcia, Peralta, Wong, and Carpenter on the infield. Tony Cruz behind the plate. Presented by Dobbs Tire and Auto Centers. You might be looking at the MVP of the National League here. Paul Goldschmidt. 2-2. Pittsburgh has posted a win. Garrett Cole made that start. 2-1 the final over Miami. Cole had been 1-4 in seven starts since the All-Star break. Goldschmidt to short. There's Peralta, and he makes the play. Leadoff walk erased on the double play. Goldschmidt grounds out. 1-0 after one. Tony Cruz hitting 177. 7, 8, and 9 in the lineup for the Cardinals. We were talking during the break about Johnny Peralta. Seems to be at the right spot night after night, and anything that he can get to, for the most part, he makes the play on. And there's a lot that goes into that, isn't there?
Well, we use the word smooth a lot, smooth and steady, and there are reasons why he looks smooth and steady as a shortstop, and part of it is being in the right position most of the time. But he has an uncanny ability, Dan, to be able to get the right hop at the right time with the right runner at the plate.
Well hit, deep left field, Tony Cruz, 2-0 Cardinals. His first of 2015. Of all people, Tony Cruz goes deep here in Arizona.
A lot of smiles in the Cardinals dugout. It was a no-doubter.
First home run since September 20th of last season.
Nice moment.
David Peralta, the left fielder, barely even moved. That got out in a hurry, and it's a 2-0 lead. His last home run was off of Mike Leake, who's now pitching for the San Francisco Giants. We'll be in San Francisco tomorrow. It'll be Michael Wacha, Mike Leake tomorrow night.
Kind of have mixed feelings about missing Madison Bumgarner. You love to watch him pitch, but you sure don't like to watch him pitch against the team that you're interested in winning. And he is, of course, capable of coming off the bench. We saw that, but he pitched today and had 12 strikeouts.
Let's go back to the home run for Tony Cruz, his first of the season, RBI number 5.
Pitch up in the zone, and he turned on it. Just jumped on it, knew it right away.
441 feet. The distance of that home run. And here's Carlos Martinez. He has four sacrifices this year. Goldschmidt holding the runner at first. That's Garcia. Third baseman Jake Lamb is in on the grass. Martinez squares to bunt. Gets it down. De La Rosa to second. Safe, and everybody safe. Throw may have beat him there. However, the umpire, Chad Fairchild, said he was off the bag. And Chip Hale is motioning to the umpire crew because they may want to take a look at this. And they will review it.
Wasn't a bad bunt by Carlos Martinez. He deadened it to the right side of the infield. Credit De La Rosa for jumping off the mound so quickly and being daring enough to try to get that lead runner, but he may have made this a tougher inning depending upon what happens here with the call. Let's look at it one more time. There's the bunt. He deadens it pretty well. And there's De La Rosa. Good, strong throw. And hard to tell whether his foot is on the base or not, but Chad Fairchild said it wasn't.
I don't know if you agree with this. I'm not sure that the throw even beat him there. And his explanation was that he was off the bat.
I'm also not sure if he's catching that ball in the right spot either. Why is he catching that ball behind the runner instead of in front of the runner? Why is he not stretching forward as a first baseman might? I mean, you're not going to get a double play on that. You really, as an infielder, need to turn into more of a first baseman on a stretch play. He let that ball get in on him too much, actually behind the sliding Greg Garcia, and that's going to take more time to catch the ball back there. I've seen it three or four times, and I can't tell completely whether he's safe or out on both counts. Does the throw really beat him? Close there. Is his foot on the base? Not 100% sure of that either.
It's tough to turn, overturn this,
I think so. Been funny to me as the season has progressed how the crowd tries to manipulate a bit.
Right.
I mean, they'll see it. It'll be obvious, but they'll still cheer as if they can manipulate those making the decision in New York.
Now, this is a tough position for New York to make a call on, and I get that. So you take extended time. What I think needs to be improved upon is the decision of the manager as to whether or not to challenge the call. Sometimes that takes way too long. And I'll point to the series against Miami in St. Louis. Dan Jennings, in a couple of times, I mean, really stopped the flow of the game as to whether or not he wanted to challenge it.
You shouldn't be allowed to do that. You should not be allowed to stop the flow of the game unless you are making a commitment to challenge. I agree. And fairly quick here with Chip Hale, not an issue here, but we have seen times where that's happened. I agree 100%.
De La Rosa has been throwing just a bit, trying to stay loose.
Well, it could become gamesmanship that a manager can realize that, okay, if I let everybody know that I'm thinking about challenge it, maybe you've got to have X number of times where you are allowed to kind of stop play too. I mean, if you do it every single time, it could become, again, just a weapon to try to slow down the other pitcher or slow down the other offense, take away a little momentum, take the air out of the game.
If you're Chip Hale too, you're saying this is a big call. I'm already down by two runs. I've got Carpenter coming up who has walked and scored, but one of the better hitters in this lineup in terms of runners in scoring position.
Could see this going either way. Really had a hard time telling because you're kind of drawn to look at two different things, as the umpire is, by the way. Does the throw beat him, and where's the foot on the bag? He's got to watch two different things at the same time. And when I saw the replays, Dan, it was just hard for me to stay focused on one or the other. And they're probably looking at them separately right now in New York just to make sure this call is right.
Second time now that De La Rosa's continued to throw to stay loose. Even the fans here in Arizona starting to become a bit restless.
The overturn rate for challenges has been pretty steady since early in the season, around 50% of the calls are overturned. But that's not every call that the umpire makes, clearly. And that's not every time the manager says, hey, I want to look at it. So that just shows even the ones you want to look at, the umpires are still right half the time. So I think they do a pretty good job.
So the Cardinals will have runners at first and second. And nobody out for Matt Carpenter.
One more look. The throw beat him, but the foot may have been off the base.
After seeing that replay, I'm thinking he's out.
Yeah. No, well, I'm not sure his foot was on the bag, though.
I thought it was. But then again, I'd see it another time, and they'd say, oh, no, no.
We're going to go with him being safe. You don't get to do a second challenge, especially from the booth.
Especially from the booth. Runners at first and second for Matt Carpenter. The Cardinals have a two-run lead. And the first pitch is taken for a ball. Of concern right now for the Diamondbacks, not just that play, but De La Rosa. He's given up two extra base hits and three walks. The home run by Cruz measured at 441 feet. Here's a 1-0 pitch to Matt Carpenter.
So it'll go down as a successful sacrifice for Carlos Martinez, and he's safe on the fielder's choice. Cardinals with an opportunity to break it open here in the second inning.
Already the fifth at bat for the Cardinals with a runner in scoring position. 1-1. Now it's 1-2.
Carpenter very late on those two fastballs. 95, 96 from De La Rosa.
Last night, a tough evening for Matt facing the lefty. Went 0-for-3 against him, and then late in the game, base hit, RBI in the Cardinals' victory. Here's a 1-2 pitch. Two and two.
I think it may surprise some people, the answer to the question, who has the most strikeouts of any Cardinal player in 2015? I think many might say Brandon Moss when you count his American League time. You might say Mark Reynolds, Grichik. But the answer is Matt Carpenter.
Right.
With 108.
2-2, he hits it the other way, slicing fair just inside the left field line. Down into the corner. Garcia scores. Carpenter with a double. 3-0 St. Louis. Almost the identical spot of where Colton Wong hit his double.
And almost the identical situation where a walk by De La Rosa got him in trouble, and then the flare the other way makes him have to pay for it.
So two of the three walks have come around to score. No activity yet in the Arizona Diamondbacks bullpen. That's fair by maybe a half a foot, if that.
And we now know if that would have hit the ball boy down the left field line or the usher that's on the field, the security guard. We know from what just happened in San Diego that if they're trying to get out of the way, it's in play.
That surprised me. But there are, if you would go over the ground rules and be in those conversations with the umpires and the managers before every game, and certainly before game one of a series at a particular ballpark, you'd be shocked at some of the things that are said in those conversations about the quirkiness of each individual ballpark.
And we were teasing about the rule book, and I had it out, and how big it is. It's like the tax code, for goodness sakes. I mean, you're not, even if you do know 10 obscure rules, there's another 50 you don't know. I mean, there's a lot to this game. And as Red Chingings loves to say, if you go through a baseball season year after year, you'll always see something you've never seen before.
Runners at second and third. The infield is in. First pitch to Tommy Pham, taken for a ball. Sometimes you hear that term effectively wild. That is not the case tonight with De La Rosa.
No, he's upset. You saw him snap that ball with his glove on the throwback from the catcher Castillo. He's just not right, and he's kind of steaming right now.
Pham breaks his bat, hit into shallow center. The catch is made. Runners will stay put. I'm sure you would agree. You have to get at least one more run in this spot.
I also agree. It was not wise for the Cardinals to try to score on that fly ball to center field. There's good arms in this outfield, and I thought it was interesting that Jose Oquendo was holding Carlos Martinez. I think that's the simple part of it, but he was also communicating to Matt Carpenter that he was holding Carlos Martinez so he didn't run into an out. He gave him a signal that Carlos wasn't going.
First pitch to Hayward. Fly ball. It's a very good arm in left field, and David Peralta gets himself in a position to throw. And there's two down.
Shortstop, Johnny.
We've told you the story of David Peralta, the left fielder of the Arizona Diamondbacks, was a pitcher in the Cardinals organization. Dealt with shoulder issues and then never could get it going. Went to Venezuela, where he was born and raised, tried to make it back as a position player. He had 10 different stops in independent ball before he was finally signed. Here's Johnny Peralta. Peralta struck out back in the first inning. Cardinals with runners at second and third, and now there's two outs. Here's a 1-0. If you're Chip Hale, you're saying this is big. If he can get out of this inning trailing 3-0, it's a little momentum going his way because of second and third, nobody out, 2, 3, and 4 in the lineup coming up, and you're able to get away with it. The 2-0. Pulled foul, and it's 2-1. But a base hit by Johnny Peralta could change all that. Carpenter with the RBI, number 67, and his 30th double of the year. The 2-1 pitch to the Cardinals shortstop on its way. 3-1. Colton Wong on deck. St. Louis with a two out double from Wong back in the first to make it 1-0. Tony Cruz a home run. Solo shot, and then Matt Carpenter a double that scored a run to make it 3-0. A 3-1 pitch. Peralta grounds it to short, taken there by Owings. Cardinals strand two. However, they pick up two here at the top of the second. The first of the two runs off the bat of Tony Cruz. First home run of 2015. A frustrated De La Rosa.
You know, this is a homecoming of sorts for Mark Reynolds. He began his big league career with the Diamondbacks, played his first four seasons right here at Chase Field, and he is a big fan of this ballpark because he says how well the ball carries. So even with the roof closed, the ball still carries exceptionally well. He's put on quite the display the last few days in batting practice, and of course he hit a home run his 11th of the season in last night's win. He talked about to me earlier today about this ballpark and how much different it is than Busch Stadium, where he says you really, really got to catch it square to hit the ball out of Busch Stadium. But here, well, they go out, you know, on line drives like he hit last night, or like in batting practice on those high towering majestic shots like we've seen. And Dan, you know, even at Busch Stadium, we've seen, you and I were together when he hit that one on to Clark during batting practice a few weeks ago.
Yeah, it's fun to watch. There's no doubt. I know fans will say, well, that's batting practice. Let's see it in real games. And I get it, but it is still fun to see pure power. And that's what Mark Reynolds has.
Well, he's had seven straight years of 20 or more home runs.
A base hit off the bat of Peralta.
I think that shows that playing in Busch Stadium is a little bit tougher to get to that level.
The Cardinals with seven players in double figures in home runs this year. It brings in Wellington Castillo, who's hitting 251. 17 home runs. Picked up number 17 the other night against the Birds, and he's driven in 41.
Think about the year 2006, Dan, and we know what was happening at the big league level, and we have great memories of that. Well, young guys getting their first chance to play pro ball, 06, 07. You've got Peralta, a pitcher, in Johnson City, Tennessee. And during those seasons of 06 and 07, you've got a shortstop named Pete Cosma. You've got a shortstop named Tommy Pham.
Shortstop.
And you've got a catcher named Tony Cruz.
That's right. It is amazing when you see players and they get to this level, where they start from and how things can change in this game as opposed to other sports. I mean, if you're a football player, you're not going to go from a lineman to a running back.
Absolutely.
You know, it's more specialized that you're in that position. That's what you're going to play. But Peralta, former pitcher, now in the outfield batting cleanup. Matt Carpenter played second base, a position he had never really played before, for an entire year and was one of the best players in the league. Carlos Martinez, a former shortstop, now pitching. And a base hit on a breaking ball out to left field. So the first two have reached. This is also a sport where you're not defined by your body, so to speak, too. Tall, small, big.
I think pitcher to hitter is harder than to go from being a maybe an everyday player can't hit a curveball, so they go to a guy like Sam Tuivalala or Jason Mott and say, hey, throw this ball as hard as you can, see what happens, and all of a sudden you're throwing at 98. I mean, you expect to have guys on the field that have good arms. Mott is a former catcher, Tuivalala, a shortstop, third baseman. But I think it's hard to do what Peralta did. Once you focus on pitching, to go back and get the timing and develop as a hitter, I think that's tough.
Here's Jake Lamb, who's hitting 268. First two have reached. The Cardinals turn to double play back in the first. So a long conversation with Jim Joyce, the home plate umpire, and Chip Hale, and I'm sure that conversation was about the replay review at second base. Here's a 2-0. Jim Joyce is known for some famous calls in Major League Baseball. Maybe his famous moment in baseball happened here with the Arizona Diamondbacks. You may remember it was 3 years ago. He administered a CPR to the woman, a Diamondbacks employee, who was in cardiac arrest here at Chase Field, and saved her life. 3-1. Armando Galarraga had the near perfect game in June of 2010. No replay then. The call was wrong. And that's something that Jim Joyce will have to live with for the rest of his life. Play at first base. Call was incorrect. 3-2.
What I remember most about that was, beyond the call, was his emotions the following day. And kind of, he got a really warm kind of treatment from the Tigers at the time, and I just think he felt so crushed by that and so sad about it that I don't think I've ever seen an umpire show that much emotion over a call ever.
3-2 off the glove of Martinez into center field. The Diamondbacks get on the board. Scoring is Peralta to make it 3-1. Three consecutive singles off of Carlos Martinez.
Well, Carlos has quick hands, but he wasn't quick enough to get that one. You and I were talking before the game that maybe there's a gold glove in the future somewhere down the road for Carlos Martinez. He's so quick off the mound and really athletic, but wasn't able to come up with that one.
Part of the emotional story, by the way, just to finish it with Armando Galarraga, the next day, he was the one that brought out the lineup card, and Jim Joyce obviously was there. He was behind home plate that day, and he had tears in his eyes. He was emotional. You could see his lips trembling with emotion. From a Cardinals perspective, he had the key call in the 2013 World Series, obstruction in the bottom of the ninth of Game 3. The pressure to make that call when everybody else is trying to figure it out, including 50,000 in the stadium, the players.
It was Middlebrooks, if I recall, the third baseman for Boston, and Alan Craig was the runner, and he slides home. He says he's safe. Everybody says, wait, we tagged him. How can he be safe? And just realized, kind of after the fact, everybody realized that obstruction was called. And he was right on it at the time, did not waver. And in the midst of the confusion and the tempers, he kind of maintained his cool, to his credit.
Mm-hmm.
And he was right.
One ball, one strike on Aaron Hill. Nasty pitch that time by Martinez. 1-2 the count. And a ground ball that's hit to short. Out at second. The turn by Wong. Safe at first.
Now the Cardinals are going to take some time to look at that. And Mike Matheny is waiting for a verdict from his personnel to determine whether or not he wants to challenge that call at first.
To the naked eye, I thought he was safe.
I thought he was safe too. It was close enough though that David Bell gets on the phone.
And they will challenge.
How about that?
Hey, how about the pace of this game here for two innings?
Well, you know, the Cardinals have been very hesitant to just kind of look at a call without having some expectation for it to be overturned. And there's the foot and the catch. Boy, about the same time. Again, the ball has to be in the back of the glove. That's the stretch by Carpenter. Another close one, though, isn't it? I'd have to say he's safe.
I would too, just because, again, and you pointed it out, it has to hit the back of the glove. And if there's a shot that shows, we should have a camera angle, or at least New York will, of the ball when it hits Carpenter's glove, the back part of the glove. And you can see it when it hits the glove. And then where the foot is, to me at least, initially, I thought he was safe. Chris Owings will hit the eighth place hitter with runners at first and third. And one out.
So we now have a situation that has not happened very often. And I can't think of a game, maybe you can, Ben, of a game where you've got managers who've lost their challenges and then there may be another close play over the next few innings that they're not able to challenge. I don't recall that happening, do you?
No, I don't. Especially challenges done by the second inning. You know, I mean, that's what you're talking about this early in the game. I think you can understand why both would want to do it, though.
Sure.
Runners on at key spots. Nice play by Cruz.
I would not preclude the umpires late in the game just saying, look, we want to have a crew chief review about a close play at the plate, or, you know, you can ask them and they can talk about it. They don't have to grant it to you, but they can have a crew chief review if an important play does come up.
Two balls and no strikes. I also watch how managers talk to Jim Joyce and the players. There is a high level of respect for him. Have you noticed that as well?
Oh, yeah.
They don't really get on him all that much. It's more of a conversation of, hey, this is what we saw. This is what we're thinking. I think it's due in part because he's good, but also because of how he treats them.
A lot to be said for that. Carlos really struggling in this inning with his command. Again, 3-0.
And he walked him. So the second walk issued by Carlos Martinez. He snaps back at that baseball. De La Rosa, the pitcher, will come up with the bases loaded. Watch every out-of-market game live or on demand in true HD on over 400 mobile and connected devices with MLB.TV Premium. Real-time highlights, live look-ins, pitch tracking widget, and more. Blackout and other restrictions apply. All you have to do is visit MLB.TV for details. De La Rosa lines it near to Mark Reynolds in the Cardinals dugout for strike one.
I'm showing bunt for some reason. With the bases loaded.
And if he wants to bunt, you say thank you very much, potentially with an inning-ending double play. Here's the 0-1. Maybe we just got our answer.
Hitting 113, does have a couple of RBIs, but this is a must right here for Carlos Martinez. Strikeout at least.
0-2, fouled back.
The crazy nature of the game of baseball. You've got two hot pitchers. You're expecting a low hit game, and we're in the second inning, and both pitchers struggle.
0-2 pitch.
I think it would have been more predictable to be in the fifth inning right now with both pitchers having given up one hit.
Mm-hmm.
We've seen a ton of games like that.
Here's a 1-2 pitch on its way. There it is, a strikeout, the first of the night for Carlos Martinez.
Yeah.
So now two outs. Inciarte walked first time up. Well, the Cardinals have been exceptional this year. Their pitching staff has been with runners on and runners in scoring position. It's how you win games. Timely hitting, it's cliche, but also reverse it. Timely pitching, too. Getting out of jams. Hit sharply to second base off the glove of Wong. One run is in. The throw will go to third. Two-run score.
Colton Wong tried to get a glove on that line drive off the bat of Inciarte. Very tough. It would have been a spectacular play if he'd have made it. The ball was blistered by Inciarte. The glove's down off the end of the glove. That's really all he could do.
RBIs 35 and 36.
I will say it looked a little more catchable in slow motion than it did in fast motion.
Four hits in the inning. Here's A.J. Pollock, and he hits it out of play.
Everything looks catchable in slow motion.
Runners in scoring position at two outs. The average against Martinez this year was 121. 159 with runners in scoring position.
Tony Cruz giving a spot on the outer half of the plate, and that was an off-speed pitch that stayed up and in, so Carlos got away with that. Pollock tied himself up because he saw the spin and it just didn't break. I wouldn't do that again.
I'm sure some fans are saying at home, well, hard hit ball, but Wong has to get a body in front of it. Easier said than done. Ball was scorched.
I'm not sure he had time to do that.
Yeah, that's part of it too. Can he put him away on 0-2? Mention now the Diamondbacks came into this series riding high, five games out in the West. Tony La Russa saying the other day, it's great, we're winning games, but everybody now talking about us being in contention, it turns into distraction.
I've heard that word before.
Oh, have we ever. The 0-2. Diving stop by Garcia with the catch. Greg Garcia saves a run. Maybe two with that diving stop. Off the bat of A.J. Pollock. Arizona picks up three. They tie the game up. Nice play, Greg Garcia. We head to the third. It's a new game here in Arizona. Wong has an RBI double. And again, I'll go back to second and third, nobody out. 2, 3, and 4 coming up, and the Cardinals do not score.
Well, he earned that part, but then he's got to feel like he just got a gift in the bottom half of the second inning with the three runs being scored.
The Cubs lose today, as we mentioned, 9-1 against Madison Bumgarner. And Chicago has acquired Fernando Rodney, former closer with the Seattle Mariners. Chopped towards second base. One away. Jason Mott is on the DL. Soler is on the DL. So trying to bolster their bullpen as we head into September, as it brings in Brandon Moss.
Left field.
That's an odd group.
Cardinals, Cubs, Blue Jays.
I don't mean to call them odd. I guess I just mean the
Shirts.
The shirts are odd.
Right.
Yes. I'm sure they're wonderful people.
Make sure you stay politically correct.
Well, I mean, that's somebody's friend.
Cover your tracks.
Cousin. And, I mean.
Oh, and two on Moss. You know, Jim Hayes would be all over that.
Oh, he would go try to figure out now how do you all know each other, and where did this come from, and has this been? I think he would get the deep story. Well, maybe Pat Parrish can.
That's where I was going.
All right, I'm helping you there.
It's our last night with Pat here in Arizona. Jim will be with us in San Francisco beginning tomorrow. First of three against the Giants. Always a fun atmosphere. They're in deep conversation right now. We always talk about you come to the ballpark, you know, you get your peanuts, popcorn, your Cracker Jack. You sit down with family and friends. You have a great conversation about not only the game, but life itself. And then you see this.
They look like they're in a college lecture on philosophy or something. You know that look.
I didn't go to many classes.
If you did, you would have looked like that.
No, my head would have been on the desk. Four walks for De La Rosa. Randy Johnson, by the way, in the house tonight. One player in the Hall of Fame for the Arizona Diamondbacks. Randy Johnson, Angels with Nolan Ryan. Biggio for Houston. Brett, Kansas City. Seaver with the Mets. I talked to Bob Brenly, and there's Bob there on the right. Randy Johnson in the center. And he said, I cannot believe what it's like talking to Randy Johnson now. And you would understand this. He said he was so locked in as a player, so aggressive, to an extent so mean, that I cannot believe that this man is as talkative as he is now. He has taken up photography. It's a passion of his. He studied that at USC. He said he's one of the chattiest people he's around now. And Bob would know, as Bob was the manager of that world championship team here in Arizona. He said it's really one of the biggest turnarounds of an individual he's seen. Not in a bad way, just
no.
That's the way he was as a player.
Well, I think there are times where guys do blossom with their personality after they're done playing, and they just won't allow themselves to kind of be free enough to engage. They feel like they've got a job to do, work to do, and don't really want to get distracted. Back to that word again.
Randy Johnson, 8 seasons, 2 different stints with Arizona, was 118 and 62. 4 Cy Young Awards with Arizona. And we're talking about guys going deep into games and way, way back when. And now that's a balk on De La Rosa, called by the home plate umpire Jim Joyce. But Randy Johnson, he never pitched fewer than 248 innings.
One of the most dominating pitchers I've ever seen in this game when he was at his best. So where's the balk? He starts, then he stops. At times pitchers will do that because they maybe didn't see the sign. And they thought they saw it, then they didn't, then they stopped. You can't do that.
Tony Cruz is homered here tonight. We mentioned his last home run coming last September. That was in regular season play. You may recall his home run in postseason play that he had as well.
I remember his first home run. It was in Miami. And he had a lot of family and friends there at the ballpark. And very meaningful moment for Tony.
Runner at second is Brandon Moss. Randy Johnson, when he threw his perfect game, he was 40. That was against Atlanta on the road. His number is retired, number 51, the only other number retired by the franchise. Luis Gonzalez, who works in the front office, had the game-winning hit of the 2001 World Series. The 2-2. In my mind, it's arguably the greatest World Series that's ever been played because of 9/11. And the great games that they had. It went seven games. They had the dramatic finishes in New York with the home runs given up by Byung-Hun Kim, who was the closer at the time. Derek Jeter became Mr. November.
There were meaningful moments in that series that really transcended baseball.
Absolutely. Runner at second, Brandon Moss. Big gap in left center field. And Cruz pops it up to the right side. On the outfield grass, it's Aaron Hill. Ironically enough, it was Nolan Ryan who changed his career. Changed his delivery to the plate. Remember how wild he was when he came into the big leagues? More about stepping directly to the plate and not throwing from the side.
I mentioned Johnson, one of the most dominating pitchers I've ever seen in his prime. I'd have to kind of throw Nolan Ryan into that mix as well. There are times where you'd see Nolan Ryan pitch and you would expect there to be no hits through five innings every time. You think you might get to him, but you'd be lucky to foul a pitch off the first five innings.
You grew up a Mets fan too, and
saw him pitch as a 19-year-old at Shea Stadium.
Throwing hard, I would imagine.
Oh yeah. All the Mets threw hard back in those days.
Here's a 1-1 to Garcia. One ball and two strikes. Brandon Moss, the runner at second base. The 1-2 pitch to Garcia. Put in play to second. Taken there by Hill. Cardinals strand a runner. They've stranded five through three innings. Great Randy Johnson, now a Hall of Famer. It's 3-3. Slugging percentage leaders in the National League this year. Goldschmidt at 570, trailing only Bryce Harper. First pitch is a strike. Last year was cut short. He was hit on a pitch August 1st against Pittsburgh, suffered a fractured hand. An injury is a big part of the Diamondbacks' 98 loss season a year ago. They had four regulars miss over 100 combined weeks. Good breaking ball that time. What's interesting is that at one point the Diamondbacks weren't sure about Goldschmidt. Is he going to be the kind of player that they're seeing today? They offered Paul Konerko 3 years and $30 million to bring him into Arizona. Obviously did not sign, went back to the White Sox. And the Diamondbacks have a very club friendly deal with Paul Goldschmidt. Martinez stays with it. Makes the play.
Ball hit hard up the middle and is able to get a glove and maybe even a leg on it. And off balance throw, he probably could have set himself to make the throw, but again, he's just an athletic guy and he doesn't do things defensively the way every pitcher in baseball does. He's a little more, I guess I would say, more flair to him. But I do think it's possible, because he's so athletic, that he could be a Gold Glove winner at some point.
Here's David Peralta. Do you think the baseball world should be giving more attention to David Peralta for doing what he's doing here?
Well, you said it yesterday. You got my attention very astutely, I might add, when you said, hey, this guy's hitting cleanup for the best offense in the National League. And how much attention is this guy getting? I mean, he's not getting much less probably than A.J. Pollock is either, and he's having a big year. But Peralta's really been impressive.
0-2 pitch and a changeup. Second strikeout for Carlos Martinez. I mean, if you had a former pitcher that would be batting cleanup for the New York Yankees or the Mets or a team in Chicago.
Well, and I made the point earlier that I do believe it's much harder to go from an everyday player in the minor leagues, kind of thwarting, or everyday pitcher, I should say, in the minor leagues, and then kind of get hurt and then have to go back to being an everyday player. I think the development process, I think that's tougher. So when Rick Ankiel did what he did, I found that utterly amazing, that he could go that many years without focusing on hitting and all of a sudden turn it around and become not just a guy that can hit, but your best power prospect, and then ultimately a big league outfielder.
Peralta played for the Wichita Wingnuts. Everybody knows them. Rio Grande Valley White Wings. Played in Amarillo, Texas.
The what? The say that again.
Rio Grande Valley White Wings.
There is not enough space on a uniform to put that team name on there. You just use the
wings.
Wings, okay.
You can deal with that.
Maybe just an acronym.
That would work. There's a strike. This has been a better looking inning, even
yes,
compared to the first.
The pace is better. And you asked about that earlier. The pace, very important for Carlos Martinez. He needs to be slow, but not too slow. Much better.
For our fans that don't know, Rick Horton not only played in the major leagues, won a World Series championship, championship teams in St. Louis, but you were a pitching coach, so you know a little bit about mechanics and what's going on between the ears too.
Well, you learn to watch that when you're a coach, and maybe in a way that you never did as a player. I mean, when you watch day in and day out, and you try to get the best out of everybody that you have, they all have different kind of arms, but you notice things in terms of pace and kind of the action on a baseball, and just kind of what we've seen from Carlos Martinez. Pace much better in that inning. A nice 1-2-3 inning for the young right hander.
Coach and player in the NHL, Chris Kerber will be the MC along with John Kelly. So happy for Chris Pronger to see him head to the Hall of Fame. Here's a 1-0 pitch to Martinez, showing bunt, and looks at a strike.
Very deserving for Chris Pronger. But speaking of happy, Dan, I am incredibly happy at this moment, because between innings here at Chase Field, they showed baseball bloopers. And boy, do I miss seeing those.
And they were the old school ones.
Old school bloopers. And it used to be a normal thing you'd see at the ballpark. This Week in Baseball would have it every weekend for baseball fans. That was kind of the once a week opportunity for a young baseball fan to see what was going on around the rest of the baseball world.
Yeah, our fans now, the young ones, they have no idea. I mean, every game now is on TV. You see the highlights, you see miscues. As Martinez lines it foul, but that was the only way to be able to get what was happening in baseball with This Week in Baseball.
Mel Allen,
that famous voice. I used to think the show that Johnny Bench did, I used to love watching that. It was one of my favorite shows. Something Bunch. What am I? I'm drawing the
baseball bunch.
Baseball Bunch. Thank you.
Oh, yeah. I wonder if players today actually grew up with those bloopers or if they're just past that age.
They're past it. It's Goldschmidt backs up and makes the catch. I think guys, what, maybe 37, 38, they may remember it, maybe.
There was a video that they showed year after year. It was one of the classic bloopers of a grounds crew guy that was trying to get a runaway cat off the field, and he picked him up, and he's dragging him off the field, and all of a sudden the cat starts biting him, and he kind of flips the cat out of his hand, and he starts to kind of jump up and down in pain. And, of course, we all think that's funny. Wasn't to him, but it was. No. It was just an ongoing thing year after year, that particular blooper.
Here's Matt Carpenter. A double and an RBI. A walk, run scored.
Here's a project for you, Dan. Bring back a show of baseball bloopers. Mm-hmm. It's all you need is another project.
There are reels of those that teams do get. There are some that are out there. They're just not shown with regularity anymore. Much of that is because of the sponsorship inside the ballparks. You know, you may have a player profile or looking at the top plays of your team, whatever the case may be. As Carpenter pops it foul. Oh, and two the count.
So you celebrate the wonderful moments, and we still do that. But you have to celebrate the imperfections of this game as well, don't you?
Well, would you like to be part of that, though? If you had a blooper?
I would like to be part of watching it, yes. But that's not what you're asking.
Now we get to the truth. I know you're fond of the Kiss Cam. It's one of your favorites at the ballpark.
Prefer the bloopers.
Now, Tony Simikaitis runs the scoreboard along with Craig Wilson, a host of others at Busch Stadium. And we have the Shane Company bloopers every other game, he tells us. By the way, he also said, thanks for noticing.
I think what we've done is we've told a lot of Cardinal fans, you better start noticing that.
That's right. Strikeout of Carpenter, and that's three tonight for Ruby De La Rosa.
That's a deep tease. That's what we call that in the business.
Mm-hmm.
Next homestand.
I'll be looking for it now.
The Shane Company bloopers.
Here's Tommy Pham, who has walked and also fly to center. And a bouncer to short, backhanded by Chris Owings. And the Cardinals go in order. Five in a row set down by the Arizona right-hander. Speaking of bloopers, as it pertains to this game, do you remember the highlight of a minor league outfielder that literally runs through the wall?
Yes.
His name is Rodney McCray. That pitch taken low. Many of you have seen it and probably remember it. He's attempting to catch a fly ball. He runs through the wall, literally ran through the wall. That ball was hit by the Diamondbacks manager, Chip Hale. How about that?
That's amazing.
He goes right through the wall, a wooden wall. 2-1 the count.
I'm going to have to find that video again and look at it. It's been years since I've seen it, but almost incredible to watch because he does. He literally goes through the fence.
Full speed. That may be, I think, maybe your top five in baseball bloopers.
You would add the ball hitting off the top of the head of Jose Canseco in right field and going over the fence for a home run. That one was fun.
I always liked seeing it, too. Then he had to intersperse the hot foot.
Oh, yeah.
Peralta to his left, and from his knees, what a play, Johnny Peralta. Robbing Jake Lamb.
Second baseman, Aaron Hill.
No blooper there. We were talking earlier about Johnny Peralta always getting good hops. And what about the hop there? It was about him just diving and making an athletic play to his left. But Peralta continues to find ways to get good, balanced positioning to make plays defensively, and that's why we call him smooth and steady.
You know, we were talking about it too. This is Aaron Hill. With the advent of all these shifts and the analytical analysis that the Cardinals and every team puts together, Peralta just seems to be at the right place, right time, more times than not. If he's playing a straight-up traditional shortstop, he doesn't make that play.
Well, I credit Johnny Peralta for that, but you have to credit Jose Oquendo and a number of people that work in the Cardinals analytics department for offering those suggestions and the theories behind it that lead to that positioning. That's a group thing. That's just not Peralta. That's a lot of people coaching him up and giving him information that he can use to be as steady as he's been.
Hill flies to left. The Chevy Fox tracks, and it brings in Chris Owings.
Both starters settling down a bit.
Owings, the eighth place hitter, walked his first time up. We're tied up at 3-3, bottom of the fourth. And no blooper reel would be complete without the bubble gum on top of the cap.
Of course.
Biggest prankster you've dealt with?
Well, there were a couple of years that I probably would say it was me. Spent a year with the White Sox where they didn't have anybody doing it, so I had to kind of take over.
Nice, sweet little Ricky Horton.
Well, you mentioned hot foot, and that kind of reminded me of
me.
So did a few of those. Didn't play with Roger McDowell, but he was noted for being the one who was probably the biggest prankster of that era. That's really what he was doing all day long, thinking of a prank, of something funny, something odd. And now he's a pitching coach in the big leagues, telling young guys not to do that.
Right. A strikeout for Carlos Martinez, number 3 tonight. And as Rick said, both pitchers have settled in. Tremendous play by Peralta. 3-3 as we head to the fifth. 3-3 game. And here is Jason Hayward. It'll be Hayward, Peralta, and Wong. Again, you go back. Cardinals a 3-run lead against De La Rosa. Runners at second and third, nobody out. The shift was on here for Hayward, and the Cardinals did not score in that second inning. It's time to turn to our DraftKings leaderboard and the players to watch. Rookies in August: Bryant, Piscotty, Schwarber, and Matt Duffy. Most total bases. DraftKings.com. Enter promo code CARDS. Kyle Schwarber's had quite the impact with the Chicago Cubs.
And so is Stephen Piscotty, getting the night off here. Piscotty really kind of came into his own when Grichuk went down. Not that he wasn't here already, but they're just needing his bat and what he brings. And both Grichuk and Piscotty have been important parts of this Cardinals team this season. Very important parts.
Quickly, no balls and two strikes on Johnny Peralta, who is struck out and also grounded out to short. Good sinking action on that pitch. Strikeout number 4.
We talked about his fastball, particularly the sinker, being flat in the first inning. This one's not flat. This one has downward movement. That's what he was searching for early on, being on top of it, fingers on top of the ball, creating a little bit of downward spin on the sinker, and he throws a hard one.
Here's Colton Wong, a double inside the third base line. With two outs, that scored Carpenter for the first run in our contest. Cardinals then picked up two runs in the second. Diamondbacks have come with three of their own.
I would not have bet somewhere in the middle of that second inning that De La Rosa would still be in this ballgame in the fifth.
He had walked three in the first two innings. Number four came in the third. Here's a 1-1 pitch.
He's bringing it now. Feeling it, bringing it, pitching, not just throwing as he did in the early going.
You wouldn't believe all the people sending us videos of the bloopers that we like.
We've got plenty to do between innings.
Wong up the middle, base hit. The first Cardinal hit since back in the second inning.
But we do thank everybody for sending them to us. They're fun.
It had been seven straight retired by De La Rosa.
Back up the box. Pete Cosma telling us a couple of days ago that this infield's quick. Just like the infield in San Diego. So you hit the ball on the ground hard, it's going to get through the infield faster than other fields will be. A little harder.
Two outs and a check on Wong, who has 14 steals this year.
He made a point to me that I can honestly say I haven't thought a lot about before, that sometimes turns a ballpark into being a hitter's ballpark. How fast the infield is. Not just you can focus on the fences and how far you can hit a home run and that makes it a hitter's ballpark or not, but what about the infield?
Think about when the Chicago Cubs, before they evened out the level playing field now in the infield, they had that crown on it. I mean, they used to let that grass grow seem like a foot high, and that's driven out to deep right field, and it is a home run. Brandon Moss first as a Cardinal, a two-run shot. And the Cardinals go on top 5-3. He needed that one.
His best moment as a Cardinal so far. Colton Wong gets on before him. And Moss does what you told me before the game, Dan McLaughlin. He does what you said he would do, and that's hit a home run. Wow, pretty good attempt there by Inciarte. He didn't miss that ball by very much. That would have been some play.
The reason I said that to you was the uppercut and the sinker. Thought it might be a good combination for him. As Cruz good. Hits it sharply to first.
Good call, right on it. As was Brandon Moss.
Perfect timing in this game. Breaks a 3-3 tie. Moss is first as a Cardinal. Inciarte nearly pulled it back in. Great effort. 5-3 St. Louis.
Two of the walks today that the Diamondbacks issued to the Cardinals scored. Carpenter in the first and a walk to Garcia in the second inning. And you're always asking for trouble. Both innings really very similar, Dan. Walks hurt you. Bloop hit the other way in both cases. First it was Wong, then it was Carpenter. But the big hit, Brandon Moss, his first home run since the 18th of July. And congratulations, Brandon, for your first home run as a Cardinal.
16 now on the year. Yasmani Tomas will pinch hit. Tomas, the big signing for Arizona in the offseason. $68.5 million over 6 years. $14 million of the signing bonus. $36 million in the first 4 years, and then he can opt out. Tomas is an outfielder. They tried him at third. It hasn't worked out. Where does he fit right now with this Diamondbacks team?
Well, if he's a man without a position, it's a really good question. Right now, he fits on their bench as a pinch hitter. But he's just 2-for-16 in that role.
Hit the Cardinals well in the 3 games in St. Louis.
He sure did.
And the 2-1 pitch. 3 balls and 1 strike.
Am I being overly optimistic in thinking that this could be opening the floodgates for Brandon Moss offensively? Maybe feeling a little looser, a little more confident at the plate going forward.
On a hop to short, there's Peralta. Take another look at the Inciarte effort.
He climbs the wall. He's trying to make a spectacular catch, and I know Brandon Moss has told Jim Hayes quite a few times and Pat Parris that he's hit into some bad luck this season. He's not complaining about it, but he's hit into some bad luck, and boy, that would have been painful if Inciarte would have been able to bring that one back.
And you know, you think about it, Ricky, to further your point, as Inciarte now at the plate, been on base twice. 2 hops hit to Peralta. You get the feeling he put a lot of pressure on himself coming from a team that's going nowhere to the best team in baseball record wise. Hey, these guys wanted me. They're dealing with injuries. They're expecting a lot from me. And then he comes out of the gates and not hitting all that well. So does it open up the floodgates? Maybe, you know, maybe you just need to get that first big hit and home run under his belt.
There's a very real difference, too, for playing on a team that is fighting for a division title and is 30 plus games over 500 and has high expectations. And I'm not just talking about the Cardinals now, but just when you're playing on a team like that and you get traded to a team like that, very different feel than just the new guy on a team that's playing 500. It just is. Every day at the ballpark is a little bit more electric, a little bit more scrutiny. So if you get traded to the Kansas City Royals right now, it's different than if you get traded to the Seattle Mariners.
Sure.
And I'm not picking on the Seattle Mariners. It's just a fact. They're going to be talking about development. They're going to be talking about next year. But the Royals will be talking about today.
The now.
The now and the October.
Here's a 2-1 pitch to A.J. Pollock. Three and one. Pollock has had a tough series. Grounded into a double play back in the first. And with two runners on, lined out to Garcia. And that took a hit and maybe two RBIs away, at least one. Coming into the series, Pollock, one of the hottest hitters in baseball, and the Cardinals have cooled him off a bit. 3-1 pitch. 3-2.
If Pollock lines out to somebody, he might snap. Because he's done that a lot in this series.
Three, two pitch. I haven't really noticed it, but is Martinez shaking off Cruz a little bit more than he would with Yachty?
Haven't seen much of it. And I don't really mind a pitcher shaking off Yachty Molina. I'd maybe in the minority with that, but I haven't really seen a lot of difference.
On the outside corner. Now he may really snap. He just threw his helmet, came right back up off the ground back to him. And he's lucky that did. He may get tossed. Randy Ed going.
We're trying to start a new blooper video, aren't we? You could get some of the races, the president's race, the hot dog race. I mean, that could be part of it.
Randy Johnson, Matt Williams, Luis Gonzalez, Mark Grace, all in the race. Matt Reynolds is the new pitcher. He will face Mark Reynolds, the new hitter. We had this matchup the other night. Reynolds on the first pitch. Skies it into left center field. There's A.J. Pollock. And there's one away to start the sixth. So Reynolds pinch hits for Greg Garcia. Just wonder if the thumb was bothering him from the other night.
Or is it just a matter of
the lefty?
The Cardinals were trying to start all their lefties today, which they did. All players on the bench hit from the right side. And getting deeper into the game, maybe Mike Matheny wanting to have more of his A defense. Guys at least that are used to playing the positions that they normally play, get him back.
Take a look at our Kia in the driver's seat. Matt Carpenter hitting above 300 as a leadoff man and the highest on base percentage leading off an inning at 365. And in this particular case, he'll hit with two outs.
A.J. Pollock on that list.
And a strike to Carpenter, who has walked and scored. Doubled inside the third baseline, picked up an RBI, and then struck out swinging in the fourth. The Cardinals hold on and win this game. It'd be win number 82. Pittsburgh would stay 4.5 games back. Chicago 7.5 games out. It would be 8.5 at the end of the night if St. Louis would win. Popped up into shallow left. Here's Peralta, and he'll make the catch. So the Cardinals go in order. Martinez back to work when we come back to the desert. 5-3 St. Louis. What's on Tap is presented by Budweiser as we come your way tomorrow at 8:30 St. Louis time. Good matchup. Pair of right-handers, Michael Wacha, 15-4. Mike Leake is 9-6. We did not see Leake in the previous series against the Giants at home, dealing with a hamstring injury, but the last time we did see him, he shut down the Cardinals in his final start as a Cincinnati Red. Here's Goldschmidt, 0-for-2 with a pair of groundouts. Reynolds stays in the game at first base. Carpenter shifts from first to third. Martinez has set down 10 straight after a rough second inning.
Martinez has been a little more fallible in the month of August. He hasn't had his blowout games where he's striking out 8, no runs, 7 innings that we saw so much in the early going. Just wonder whether the innings are starting to pile up a bit for him too. You'd like for him to finish strong, of course. He still has an outside shot, maybe even better than that, at 200 strikeouts this season.
I think you have to think about the winter ball innings too. 30 or so in winter ball. Couple that with spring training and now here in regular season play. His spring training is not like a guy that was established in the rotation too. I mean, every fifth day for him in spring training, it's an important start.
Absolutely.
How about that? Fell behind 3-0, comes back to get Goldschmidt. Two consecutive strikeouts and five in the game.
He reared back for a little more on that one, didn't he? High, hard one. I'm glad Goldschmidt didn't hit that ball because I don't think it would be on the ground yet.
What was it measured yesterday?
471.
471.
Unofficially, I heard people talk about that being the third longest home run in Major League Baseball this season.
With Giancarlo Stanton, the top two. Off the end of the bat, and it's no balls and two strikes. Boy, Martinez really has picked up the pace, too.
Goldschmidt's home run was also unofficially the loudest home run of the season. The bat crack. I mean, it was a blast.
Back to Carlos. He'll flip to Reynolds for out number two. September 4th, 25,000 fans ages 16 and older receive a replica 1967 World Series Champions ring. One of a kind ring has a detachable base so you can wear it. At September 4th, the Cards and the Pirates. Cardinals.com/promotions. They were getting ready for a selfie, Rick. That's the bonus of having Jim back with us tomorrow. He'll bring his selfie stick. Castillo is 1-for-2.
Jim holding down the fort on the postgame show following this game. He and Jim Edmonds will talk through all the things that we've seen so far and have yet to see. A 5-3 game. I'm guessing there's going to be a lot more important plays to follow here in the last three innings.
2-1 on Castillo.
The bullpens are going to become very important. Cardinals hoping, of course, to use Trevor Rosenthal.
Trevor will not be with the club this weekend. He'll be back home for the birth of his second daughter. First of three with the Nationals on Monday night at Busch Stadium, off day on Thursday, and then we'll see Pittsburgh and Chicago. Very important homestand coming up. If Pittsburgh finishes second in the race to the Cardinals this year, they can look back to what they've done inside the Central Division. 21-29. The Cardinals are 14 games above 500 inside the division. Three-two pitch, and he got him. Freezes Wellington Castillo. 13 in a row set down by Carlos Martinez. He is through six. We head to the seventh.
And Jay, the last 4 days here in Arizona. Remember, he first began taking live BP Monday when we got here before game one of this four-game set, and he's progressed so quickly that the Cardinals are sending him out tomorrow. He'll meet up with the AAA Memphis Redbirds tomorrow night in Reno, Nevada. The Redbirds are playing there tonight through Sunday, and so it'll be his first opportunity to see live pitching, and he'll get into a game hopefully sometime this weekend. So kind of a rapid progression here for John Jay, a guy that they could really use coming off the bench, and we all know how special a player he's been over the last several years.
And Pat, Tommy Pham has given the Cardinals, I think, a welcome dose of relief in terms of not having to push John Jay if they don't elect to do that.
Well, it's funny, Dan. You know, wherever we go, we keep getting asked.
That's a fair ball fought off by Pham, who was not running out of the box. I'm not sure he knew where that was.
We get it on Twitter, Dan. We get it when Cardinal fans come up to us, even here at the ballpark. What are the Cardinals going to do when all the outfielders get healthy? What are they going to do when all the first basemen get healthy? you know, they all seem to work themselves out, so it really doesn't matter. But it has been such a great boost for Tommy Pham to do what he's doing when you think that Randall Grichuk is on the sideline. You've got John Jay, who's been out much of the season. It just shows the depth of this organization.
All right, Pat, thanks. Here's Hayward, who is 0-for-3, and let's see if Pham and the Cardinals want to do a little running up by two runs.
We understand why fans are asking that question, because you start to kind of project Holiday's back. Now what do we do? Adams is back. Now what do we do? But it does work itself out. And if you're playing well, you'll get to keep playing.
Five-three, St. Louis. Runner at first, Tommy Pham. Ground ball slowly hit to the right side. Only play to get Hayward, and Pham is in scoring position. This is the Gateway Honda home run inning. Cardinals hit a home run. The Gateway Honda dealers donate $1,000 to the Make-A-Wish Foundation. Mentioned that Washington coming to town Monday. Denard Span may be out for the year. It would be a tremendous loss for the Nationals. They did win tonight. We'll see the intentional walk here to Peralta, but so did the Mets. Mets now have won 7 straight. Their lead is 6.5. So Chip Hale wants to go lefty-lefty here with Reynolds and Wong. This will be the 5th walk the Cardinals have received tonight. Colton Wong with runners at first and second. AT&T, U-verse Rewind, and the Cardinals using the long ball tonight. First of the year, Tony Cruz. First as a Cardinal, Brandon Moss. That breaks a 3-3 tie.
It was a very long conversation between innings with Mike Matheny and Derek Lilliquist and other coaches, in fact, about how to handle the pitching.
Well, you got to think, if Rosenthal is leaving the club, he's got the 9th. Pitched yesterday, but they're going to use him tonight, so it really shortens the game potentially.
Backing up to what you do in the 7th and 8th, though, the question revolves around the pitch count of Carlos Martinez. I think he's up to 103 pitches through 6 innings. He's finished well. He's going well. There's lefty to lead off the bottom of the 7th inning. Do you take him out now? Do you keep him in? I think it's kind of a tweener, and I think that's why there were so many involved in that conversation, and Mike was really kind of looking, it appeared from what I saw, really looking for some input as to which way to go with Carlos Martinez here.
He set down 13 straight.
It's a factor.
Yeah.
There's a lot of factors in it.
Here's Moss with runners at second and third. 2 balls, no strikes. Tony Cruz on deck. Sweeping breaking ball for a strike. Three and two. Mazda game summary. Moss 3-2 with 2 runners on. He is homered here tonight. Martinez, as Rick went through what he's done this evening, pitching well. De La Rosa, 5 innings, 5 hits, 5 earned. Inciarte is 1-for-2 with a pair of RBIs. Big pitch here on 3-2. 2 outs, 2 on. The next to Moss. Taken low and away. He draws another walk. So the base is loaded here for Tony Cruz. And Chip Hale will go to his bullpen. Cruz. Cruz hit a home run back in the second. He has popped out and grounded out Addison Reed, the right-hander, and a Chevy call to the pen in for Arizona.
Tony Cruz already has a big hit in this game, and he can get another one right here. Two-run lead. Cardinals could break it open here. Might alter how Mike Matheny uses his bullpen.
Absolutely. Way outside for ball one. Hyundai pitch arsenal on Addison Reed.
Two pitch pitcher. He missed badly with that first delivery. I'd make him throw a strike after that.
One ball, one strike. No grand slams in his career this year. 0 for 2 with a strikeout. 231 is average. In his career with the bases loaded. One ball, one strike. One and two.
Cardinals minor league affiliate, the Peoria Chiefs, are headed to the playoffs. They had their celebration today. Congratulations to their players and staff. Talked about developing young players to be the next Cardinals. 3 or 4 or 5 years down the road, that's happening right now in Peoria.
Here's a 1-2 pitch to Tony Cruz. Nice play by Castillo. Pretty big gap in left center field. Hits that gap. The Cardinals potentially score three.
Castillo's done a nice job behind the plate. He's quicker than you might think he is. Big guy. But very agile behind the plate. That was a tough one. That was a slider going away from him. And he had to corner it, had to kind of get the right angle with his glove to make sure it was going to stay in front of him. That was really a terrific play.
2-2. Strikeout of Cruz. And it's time to stretch. As Tony strands the bases loaded, the Cardinals have stranded 8 in this game. It's 5-3 St. Louis. Overall this year, they've been very good.
Opponent's batting average is 207 in the month of August. Really, the only way that works is if everyone is contributing. It's a group effort, and the first of that group to see action here tonight in the final game of the series is Randy Choate, appearance number 61. He's our Chevy called to the bullpen. He'll have the left-handed hitting Jake Lamb. We haven't talked a whole lot about him in this series, but he's a promising young player for the Diamondbacks. And perhaps the only batter that Randy Choate will face.
That's what I'm thinking.
Odd for that to happen in the seventh inning, but appears that that's where we're going here.
And I guess if you're Mike Matheny, you're saying I've got 6 outs to play with to get to Rosenthal.
Less than that.
Exactly. So I'm going to treat this as the game is on the line right here, because really, you think about it, you'd like to save him for potentially, let's say, a Peralta for sure on that list, maybe Enciarte. Peter Borges takes over in center. Tommy Pham is in left field. And that's a base hit. Well, regardless, who saved a showed for any of these hitters, it doesn't matter. Jake Lamb is aboard, and here comes Mike Matheny.
He'll go to his bullpen again. The Diamondbacks now with the tying run at the plate here in the seventh inning. The wheels are turning. We have another Chevy call to the bullpen. Cardinals trying to hang out. Precious outs to get in the seventh, eighth, and ninth.
Here's Jonathan Broxton, our Chevy call to the pen.
Is there a difference?
Jim can get on you every once in a while, you know?
In a good way.
Absolutely.
In a great way. Players love their time with him. Jonathan Broxton, important appearance for him.
I think I'm concerned right now for the Cardinals. Randy Choate has not recorded an out in four of his last seven appearances.
Couldn't get the left-hander Lamb. He's aboard at first base. Broxton can pick him up with a ground ball here.
Cardinals have turned a double play tonight. Here's a 1-0 pitch. There's your ground ball. Slowly hit. Out at second. They'll get the lead man. Book is closed, by the way, on Carlos Martinez, who strikes out six in six innings, gives up the three runs, and when he left the game, he had set down 13 straight. Here's Chris Owings. One out, runner at first. One thing I've already noticed from Broxton, pitches down in the zone. I thought the last couple of appearances got away with it, but some pitches up.
Especially the slider. It gets underneath it a little bit. Good sinking action there from Broxton. Your point is well taken about Randy Choate struggling the last few times out. You'd really prefer him to be able to be interchangeable maybe from day to day with Segrist for that later lefty in the eighth or ninth inning, or especially the eighth inning. Rather kind of save him for Peralta or maybe Enciarte with a runner aboard, but being used in the seventh inning is forcing Segrist into this game. And I think Mike Matheny's a little hesitant, at least at this point, to be using Randy later until he gets things straight. That's why it's always a group thing in the bullpen. Everything one pitcher does affects how you use the next guy and the next guy.
The 2-2.
One thing about being in the bullpen, Dan, when it works correctly, it seems really easy. When it's not working well, it seems like the hardest thing in the world to get an out. And even to manage the bullpen. You're setting up the best pitcher for the best moment and the best matchup, and when it doesn't work, you've created a secondary problem.
Broxton gets the second out here in the home half of the seventh.
T
Fox Sports Midwest proud to support the Cardinals Care 6K Run September 13th. Start your race at the Stand the Man statue, run through downtown, finish on the field at Busch Stadium. For more information and to sign up, head to cardinals.com/6K. So Broxton has gotten the first two, and here is Jared Saltalamacchia, the switch hitter. And the first pitch is strike.
Six for 15 as a pinch hitter. Does have four home runs on the season. He's hit the ball hard in this series.
0-1 pitch. Went right back to that outside corner. This time didn't get the call, and it's 1-1. Runner at first is Jake Lamb. One ball and two strikes.
That pitch registering at 96 from Broxton. I don't think I've seen that number from him.
Six again.
Shook off Tony Cruz in that last sequence to throw the fastball in and then missed his spot just a little. But when you're throwing 96, you can get away with that just a little. And Tony Cruz, I think, making sure that on this next pitch, doing exactly what Broxton wants to do. I think that's the catcher's job. What are you thinking? Where do you want to go with this? And let me help you.
Here's a 1-2 pitch. Cardinals have the lead, a two-run lead, thanks to Brandon Moss. Broke a 3-3 tie. The home run back in the fifth, his first as a Cardinal. The 2-2 pitch, Broxton to Saltalamacchia. Pulled foul. Jared began the year with Miami. Now he's with the Arizona Diamondbacks, former member of the Boston Red Sox. With the Braves, Texas. He's bounced around a bit. One of the longest last names in the history of baseball. Trying to fit that name on the back of the jersey. And the 2-2. Got him. A swing and a miss. Jonathan Broxton, nice work out of the pen. Leadoff hit. Given up by Choke. And Broxton sets down the next three. Let's go to our studio at Abomarito Sports Update. All right, Jimmy, thanks. There's a look at Mark Reynolds. Hudson takes over on the mound as we move to the eighth inning here in Arizona. Chevy. Daniel Hudson, our Chevy, called to the pen.
Yeah, and he's had a nice season. He is the eighth inning pitcher. The ERA at four I don't think it's indicative of how good he's been. He's become much more reliable as their eighth inning guy setting up for Ziegler. He's always had good stuff.
It'll be Reynolds to lead it off for St. Louis. Peter Borges at the on-deck circle, then the top of the lineup. And the first pitch is taken for a ball, and we're underway. Again, we'll come your way tomorrow at 8:30 on Fox Sports Midwest. The Cardinals and the Giants. Michael Wacha and Mike Leake. Leake 9-6. Wacha will try to improve to 16-4. You were talking about Martinez getting to 200 strikeouts. Wacha could be a 20-game winner this year.
Nice to have those two great talents in one organization. Cardinals, by the way, overall, the pitching staff has given up 3 runs on 5 hits. And the Diamondbacks had 3 runs on 4 hits in the second inning alone. Very good offensive team, and the Cardinals pitching has been good here tonight.
Cishek getting loose in the pen. Did not pitch in game 3. Saw him in game 2 and looked very sharp.
I believe that's the sharpest I've seen Jonathan Broxton as a Cardinal.
Agreed. And to further that, Cishek is getting better and better as we go along here. Here's a 2-2 pitch to Mike Reynolds. You think about down the stretch here, if you want to take away some of the innings from a Wacha, a Martinez, maybe even Garcia, 36-year-old John Lackey, you can shorten the games with reliable guys. And the Cardinals, that was part of the idea here. And then shorten games if you have to in postseason play. It'd be a lot of fun. As Reynolds goes the other way against the shift. Base hit into right field. I'm sure those that follow the Diamondbacks didn't see that very often.
We've seen it more and more in the last couple of months. He still gets his share of strikeouts, but occasionally the two-strike approach just takes it the other way.
Peter Borges, the home run in this series. First plate appearance tonight. Will he be bunting? He's swinging and hits it sharply to third out there, and still they cannot turn two. A rocket to Jake Lamb, who was playing in.
He was playing in, and he's wondering why he was playing in, because that ball got on him in a hurry. He's worried about the bunt. And now he's got to react to that hard hit ball, and Borges, who can fly, got out of the box quickly and beat the throw to first. If you can't turn a double play on that against Peter Borges, I don't know how you get one.
Yeah,
because that ball was crushed.
Borges has those long strides too down the line. So they can't turn two, and here is Matt Carpenter, who's 1-for-3 tonight. Walked and scored in the first, RBI double in the second, struck out in the fourth, and flied out in the sixth. Borges, your runner at first base with one out.
You were about ready to ask whether Borges should bunt, and then he turned on that pitch. I would have liked to have seen him, although I like that at bat he had, but occasionally trying to bunt for a hit. In this kind of situation, worst thing that happens is you're out and the guy gets to second base. Best thing is you beat it out.
Sure.
And create pressure.
Yeah, we don't see that very often for Peter. If somehow he could perfect pushing it to the right side past the pitcher.
Sure.
Borges with 5 stolen bases. He has been caught 6 times.
I'd like to see him try here. The bunt you were talking about is from a right-hander, is called a push bunt. You're just pushing it to the right side of the infield and betting that you can get to first base before the second baseman can come in and make the play. From a left-hander doing that, it's called a drag bunt because you're just kind of dragging it along with you to the right side of the infield and hoping for the same thing.
And a 1-0. One ball, one strike. With the kind of speed that Borges has, I find it shocking that he's been thrown out more than he has stolen bases.
I'd like to see him go here, and I'd prefer it to the hit and run. I'd like to see Matt Carpenter at the plate with a runner in scoring position.
1-1 pitch. Makes you think, is he not getting good reads with the pitcher, the jumps? Because he is one of the fastest players in the major leagues.
Stealing bases is more than speed, as we
sure
know. And I think he probably has lost some confidence with it, frankly. Getting thrown out a few times makes you a little bit less aggressive.
He is running. Late swing by Carpenter, and Borges is thrown out. And again, just watching it from up here, and we'll take another look, I'm sure. Not a very good jump.
It was not a good jump. In fact, the first two steps seemed to go nowhere. I mean, he didn't really get the good, strong jump and get things moving quickly. It was almost like he was, I don't want to say straight up, but running in place for just a split second.
See Carpenter trying to protect him with that. 2-2. The power of two. Most home runs with 2 strikes in the big leagues this year. Carpenter with 12 of those. We know he's a great 2 strike hitter.
It's puzzling, isn't it, about Peter?
Yes. The 2-2. And Carpenter strikes out. That ends the top of the eighth. Cardinals leading 5-3. We're at Chase Field in Arizona. And Steve Cishek takes over here in the eighth inning. Our Chevy called to the pen.
Mike Napini was asked about Cishek yesterday and if he was starting to earn more and more important innings and if he thought he was getting sharper as a Cardinal. And his answers were yes and yes. This feels that his fastball has been explosive enough and the breaking pitch and the off speed pitches have been more consistent from Cishek. Got that unique delivery and throws pretty hard from that side winding delivery.
Most top guys, of the lineup.
Most guys throwing from down there don't throw as hard as he does.
You know, Cishek last year gave the Cardinals such a different look with all the hard throwers coming out of the pen. And certainly Steve Cishek has done that. His time is called. Inciarte, the leadoff man, top of their lineup, has walked, singled, drove in 2 with 2 outs back in the second, and also grounded out to short, the 0-1. Here's a 2-1 pitch. Three and one. And now I want to see Goldschmidt come up with a runner on. 3-1 pitch. Take it low, leadoff walk. Here's A.J. Pollock, 13 home runs. He's hit into a double play, lined out and struck out. And that's taken inside. We talked about the frustrations for Pollock in this series. Wonder if he was close to getting tossed after being called out on strikes back in the fifth. He slammed down his helmet. I think lucky for him, it came right back to him. He was able to catch it. He slammed it down hard.
Well, he's lucky that it came back to him and also didn't hit him in the face. We saw the tension brewing for Pollock. He's such a good player and has hit into bad luck in this series.
The 1-1.
This inning, Dan, will be fodder for the fans of baseball that love to see closers pitch in higher leverage situations against the best part of the other team's lineup, which may very well in this pit inning be the eighth inning and not the ninth.
2-1 pitch to Pollock instead. Check on the runner at first. Inciarte has 13 steals this year. And the 2-1 misses in 3-1. There's a strike, 3-2. Runner goes and it's fouled back.
Shows how much this team likes to run. Trailing by two in the eighth inning on a 3-2 pitch with a guy that hits into a lot of double plays. That's one part of it. You're also putting a lot of faith that Pollock's not going to swing and miss.
Three, two pitch. Instead, another check. Runner goes again, and it's back to back walks. Oh my. Back-to-back walks, and in steps Goldschmidt. This is absolutely the last thing that Steve Cishek wanted to do.
We talked a couple of innings ago about the importance of walks and how they can hurt a team in a game and in a series. The story up until this eighth inning has been the Diamondbacks issuing the walks and how that has hurt them.
One for seven against Cishek. And Rosenthal now grabs a baseball and begins to throw. Again, you will not have Trevor. The weekend series in San Francisco. First pitch is strike. Here's an 0-1 pitch on its way. Carpenter on the line at third. Goldschmidt tonight is hitless.
Almost as if he's not finishing his delivery and aiming it a bit. The ball's coming out a little too soon and he's missing to his arm side. Ball's just falling off to the right inside to right-handed batters. And they have to figure out those mechanics in a hurry here.
The 3-1 to Goldschmidt. Cishek has come on and walked the bases loaded. And that'll be it. Maness had been throwing and now he comes on with the bases loaded, nobody out. Cishek walked the bases loaded and now it's Seth Maness. Nobody out. Arshavi called to the pin. Double plays, we've talked about it. A big factor in this series. And now it is Peralta with the bases loaded. Cardinals need that double play. Outfield is straight away. First pitch by Maness, taken for a ball. Out of play. One ball, one strike. Hit out of play. Two strikes. Center fielder for the Cardinals is Borges. He is very, very deep. The 1-2. Peralta's still alive. ...73% inherited runners have been stranded. And the 1-2 pitch. Got him! A strikeout for Seth Maness as Peralta slams his bat and breaks it in two. Now you're a double play away from getting out of the inning.
The changeup from Maness, perfectly executed. There goes that bat.
Nine forced in 56 opportunities, the double play. Swing and a miss by Wellington Castillo. Castillo is grounded into five double plays. Now it's 0-2. The 0-2. Hit out of play. Base hit potentially ties it and probably does, as deep as the outfield is playing here for the Cardinals. Especially with the speed that's on the bases right now.
Does he come back with the changeup again?
The 0-2. He got him! Strikeout number two for Maness. One out away from getting out of this jam.
You think of Seth Maness as a ground ball pitcher, but last two batters he's been a strikeout pitcher. The changeup that often gets ground balls. It's not just the sinker. Often the changeup gets those double plays, but the bottom just dropped out of those last two pitches.
Sure did. Now it's Jake Lamb, who has one grand slam in his career with the bases loaded. This year, one for four. Bases loaded, nobody out. Bases loaded, two outs. First pitch, ground ball, pulled foul. Here is the 0-1. Tap foul, 0-2.
You go to that changeup well again. Looking for the strikeout.
The 0-2.
Fastball up. To change eye levels, perhaps to set up that change up down and away.
The 1-2 pitch, two balls and two strikes. The 2-2. Runners off with this pitch. From 0-2 to a full count. Bases loaded. And the game on the line right here. The 3-2. Ground ball. Right side. Maness is there. What a job! One of the great Houdini acts of this 2015 season. Incredible job, Seth Maness. Bases loaded, nobody out, nobody scores. A strikeout of Peralta. The strikeout of Castillo. Lamb. The ground ball. The Cardinals are out of it. They still lead as we head to the ninth. Change up this year from Seth Maness. You were all over that, talking about how the bottom was just dropping out of it.
Well, he was so confident in it, and the hitters were frustrated by it. He just kept going to it. Tony Cruz kept calling it. And Seth Maness, a guy that you just don't worry about walking people. He has the ability to throw strikes. He can throw off-speed pitches behind in the count. Very rarely does he walk a batter. But the strikeout's a huge plus. What a terrific job that was by Seth Maness.
And meanwhile, for Arizona, 11 games out in the wild card, the Dodgers posted a victory earlier today. And so Arizona could be 9 games out. After coming into this series in a homestand, a lot of home games remaining for them, 5 games out. When the pitcher fielded that ball, looked like he got it off the fingertips. So we'll take a timeout. Hayward will be the hitter when we come back. All the time that's needed for the closer, Brad Ziegler, or Chevy call to the pen. He's a sidewinder. let him get loose. Maybe the most relieved man in the ballpark right now, Steve Cishek.
Absolutely. This was not his day. Could not throw a strike. And was rescued by the terrific job by Seth Maness. A couple of strikeouts and a ground ball. Ziegler came out here and threw the first two pitches over the top, Dan, which you don't really see from him. And we can only imagine that he didn't throw much in the bullpen. I counted his total pitches in this little warm-up thing he just did on the mound, 7. Now, he must have thrown some or been playing catch in the bullpen, but that is a low number of pitches to get ready.
I did not see him getting loose, but maybe with the bases loaded, they thought, well, it could be a save opportunity. Let's get him up, get him ready. Then he sat back down with them trailing by 2, which very well could have been the case.
Makes sense.
What about this delivery, though? Is it easier, you think, maybe to get loose when you're not underhanding the ball, but it's not overhand, it's not three quarters, it's sidearm?
I've always heard people talk about that delivery, and I go back to Dan Quisenberry and Kent DeColvey threw it like that. Cecilio Guante, if you remember that name from the old Pirates teams, that you're really,
that's a name from the past.
You're really throwing the ball not that much different. You're just bending over at the waist, if you think of it that way. You bend over at the waist, which changes kind of your body angle, obviously, and then your arm angle, which makes it more of a sidearm delivery. And so I'm not sure it's much different. I'm not sure it's that easy on your arm necessarily.
Race to the bag, and Hayward is safe.
Slow and developing, wasn't it?
Sure was. Hayward is 1 for 5 tonight.
Credit Jason Hayward for getting out of the box quickly, and he beats Ziegler there, who was running the whole way, just couldn't beat him there. Falls off to the third base side. Not all pitchers, it may surprise you to hear this, not all pitchers are world-class sprinters.
Really? Coming from you, that is shocking. Peralta hits into a potential double play. Out at second and out at first as Hayward went in hard to second base. 5-3. Bottom of the ninth rolls in when we come back. Mark Melancon posted a save today down in Miami. So he's at 41. Rosenthal at 40. And he's 40 of 42 in save opportunities this year.
Save percentage through the roof for Trevor Rosenthal. Very few poor outings on the season. Consistency is there. The velocity's there. His changeup has been very effective, and he's really doing this as a two-pitch pitcher. The breaking pitch has kind of escaped him this season. There are times where he'll still break it out just to show it, and maybe it'll come back at some point, but right now it's just here, hit it, and occasionally keep you honest with that changeup.
Here's Aaron Hill. First pitch is strike at 97. Mentioned at the start of our telecast, Rosenthal, along with Lee Smith, the only Cardinals closers to have multiple 40-save campaigns. Lee Smith did it 3 different times, 91, 92, and 93. Rosenthal saved 45 games a year ago and trying to make it 41 here tonight. There's that changeup.
.88 miles an hour. 9 to 10 miles an hour off of his fastball. Could be devastating.
Here's a 1-2 pitch to Aaron Hill.
Cardinals wanting Yadier Molina to catch Trevor Rosenthal.
The Cardinals trying to pick up win number 82 here tonight. Cardinals right now have made it 8 straight seasons at 500 or better, longest streak in the National League. They win tonight, it's guaranteed, 15 out of their last 16 seasons above 500. Incredible. The 3-2, and he walked him, leadoff walk. And again, the tying run comes to the plate.
Shortstop, Chris.
Trevor had had 4 days off. So very well rested, and again, he's going to, I wouldn't say getting rest when you go back to the birth of your daughter. We all know you don't get a lot of rest there, but at least his arm will be, and not going with the team to San Francisco. Nice to see him nail this one down, go home, and everything work out well with new baby girl.
Owings is 0-for-2. Short lead at first. The 0-1 taken low. Just 4 home runs this year for Chris Owings. The 1-1 blew it by him at 98. Cardinals have never swept a 4-game series here in Arizona. And trying to have a season series sweep over the Diamondbacks of 7 games.
And a win would be 13 out of the last 14 times they've played the Diamondbacks.
The 2-2 hit the other way, slicing. Hayward is over, and he's got it near the line. Tremendous catch by Jason Hayward for out number 1. What a play that was.
I thought for sure that was a hit off the bat of Chris Owings. But Hayward shading the line a bit in right, but a direct path to the ball that would have been fair into the corner. Oh my, what a play that was. So Jose Oquendo helps kind of the defense on the infield portion of the Cardinals defense, but Chris Maloney works with the outfielders, and they had Owings played correctly.
Nick Ahmed, and that's a foul ball. One for 8 in this series. There could be no false step or a bad route on that type of play.
Absolutely not. False step, and it's a double. And the tying runs at second base with nobody out.
Here's the 0-1 pitch to Ahmed. 0-2 at 98 again from Trevor Rosenthal.
I don't believe I'd throw the changeup here way late on those fastballs.
Here's the 0-2. And he blew it by him at 97. And the Cardinals 1 out away from a sweep. We turn to our player of the game. Who else? Seth Maness came in with the bases loaded in the eighth, a two-run lead. Nobody out. Got a couple of strikeouts. No hits, no runs.
Certainly important things done on the offensive side, but what Maness did in the bottom of the eighth inning is the difference in this game.
And to think about how this road trip began, two ugly losses against San Diego, and now a chance at their fifth win in a row. They'll play behind the runner at first base with two outs. Strike one. Ender Inciarte. No other way to say it. The first two games were ugly.
I don't think you'd get an argument from anybody that saw any of those first two games. The hitting led the way in game three of the Padres series.
Ground ball and a base hit into right. Potential winning run will come to the plate. Runners at first and second, two outs. You have A.J. Pollock here, then Goldschmidt.
We talked about the closer pitching a high leverage situation in the eighth inning against the other team's best. Well, guess what? They're up in the ninth, too.
Two outs, two on. Pollock with 13 home runs this year. He's trying to make it 14.
The Diamondbacks got over 500 when we came here. As you mentioned, things looked bright. They were chasing the Dodgers. They've got a chance to refuel that drive right here in the bottom of the ninth inning with one of their best players at the plate. Chance for redemption in this series here. Or does the slide continue?
The 0-1. Now it's 0-2. Arizona down to their final strike. Pollock has had issues with the strike zone tonight. He's on deck. Rosenthal would love to end it right here. The 0-2 pitch. A strikeout of Pollock. The game comes to a close. It's a sweep, a four-game sweep of the Arizona Diamondbacks, win number 82. And the Cardinals pitching wraps it up in dramatic fashion in this series.
Seth Maness, the hero of the moment. But this Cardinals team in total doing fantastic things this season. And they have turned this road trip around, winning five straight games. They go to 37 games over 500. Martinez, a rough second inning, but then he got better after that. He picks up win number 13.
What a tremendous win for the Cardinals, and what a night for that man, Seth Maness. Great job out of the pen. Cardinals win it 5-3. It's off to San Francisco. Post-game show is next.